Welcome to Theater Corner. I'm your host, Michael Taylor. Theater Corner was created as an ongoing effort to promote more diverse interest and involvement in the theater scene. A versatile actor with a deep melodious voice, Wren T. Brown is a fourth-generation theatrical. Among Wren's film appearances are Waiting to Exhale, Hollywood Shuffle, and Midnight Clear. On television, Wren co-starred as Whoopi Goldberg's brother in NBC's Whoopi. He also guest starred or recurred on The West Wing, The Practice, Frasier, Seinfeld, Everybody Hates Chris, Grey's Anatomy, and my particular favorite, the voice of Virgil Simpson on The Simpsons. Wren has appeared in over 100 commercials and a broad range of voiceovers. In 2007, Wren founded the Ebony Repertory Theater, the first black professional theater in Los Angeles history, where he serves as its producing artistic director from inception to the institution's 10-year anniversary. Under Wren's leadership, the Ebony Repertory Theater has produced Ovation Award and NAACP Theater Award-winning productions of August Wilson's Two Trains Running, Regina Taylor's Crowns, Lorraine Hansberry's Raisin in the Sun, Jeff Stetson's Fraternity, and the musical hit Clark Peters' Five Guys Named Mo, which the Los Angeles Times reviewed as one of the more entertaining experiences available to humanity. So, silence your cell phones, folks. You're about to enter Theater Corner. Here we are. Welcome, Wren T. Brown, to Theater Corner, sir.
Michael Taylor, thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
You are so welcome. Thank you for taking out time. I know you're a very busy person, so I really appreciate you coming by.
I'm thankful to be here. Thank you.
We'd like to talk about right off the bat. I mentioned in intro that you're four generations of theatrical. What I'd like to do is go through each one, and you can tell us a little bit about each generation. And let's start with Willis Handy Young.
Willis Handy Young, my maternal great-grandfather. He was born in 1872 in Thibodaux, Louisiana. He was a multi-instrumentalist. He was a music professor. He taught his three children, Lester, Irma, and Lee Young, to play. And he also taught all of his nieces and nephews to play music. He felt it very important because his father had worked so hard as a blacksmith and as a cooper, and his mother was an evangelist. But he got a hold of music at a very tender age, and he never turned it loose. So that was my great-grandfather, Willis Handy Young. And in the aughts of the 20th century, he formed the New Orleans Strutters. And the New Orleans Strutters were on Vaudeville, the TOBA circuit, Theater Owners Booking Association, which was one of the largest black vaudeville circuit in America.
Wow. And next we have Lee Young Sr.
Lee Young Sr., born in 1914 in New Orleans, Louisiana, my mother's father, my maternal grandfather, my hero in life. He was the son of Willis Handy Young, and he became the first black staff musician in the history of Hollywood, Columbia Pictures, 1946. And also for 25 years, he was the drummer and musical director for Nat King Cole.
Incredible.
But every other hero I had came out of a book, but my grandfather was my hero living in the flesh.
Wow. And next we have Ruth Givens.
Ruth Givens, my mother's mother, my dear heart, my grandmother, my mutter, as we would call her. She was born in 1911 in Los Angeles, California. She was a torch singer and a dancer, and she played here at the Cotton Club in Los Angeles. She was in countless Hollywood films as a torch singer and dancer, and she was absolutely at the center of my heart.
Wow. And then we have Bertha McElroy.
Bertha McElroy married my paternal grandfather, Troy Brown, Sr. My grandmother was from Mobile, Alabama, born in 1906. She died, unfortunately, in 1959. I didn't get a chance to meet her. But she was a Cotton Club dancer in New York City, and she worked with Irving C. Miller and his brown skin models for many, many years.
That brings us to Troy Brown, Sr.
Troy Brown, Sr., my father's father, my paternal grandfather, born on March 17, 1900 in Memphis, Tennessee. He was the fifth black actor in Screen Actors Guild. He played Broadway in 1939. He played the London Palladium in 1933. He worked on stage as a comic. He worked in film as a comic. He sang, he danced, and he unfortunately died in 1944, so I didn't get a chance to meet either of my father's parents.
Speaking of your father, that leads us to Troy Brown Jr.
Troy Brown Jr., my father. Daddy was born in 1932 in New York City. He was a child actor. He appeared on stage and in several Hollywood pictures. But as an adult, Daddy was an exquisite jazz trumpeter. He was the most creative man I ever met in my life.
This is a rich line, a rich line of theatric. And that brings us to you. Wren T. Brown, here in Los Angeles. We are in the theater that you founded, the Ebony Repertory Theater.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit how this came about.
The Ebony Repertory Theater, it was founded in 2007, but it was incorporated in 2007. Mm. And we made our debut in February of 2008. We are the resident company and operator of this beautiful facility, the Nate Holden Performing Arts Center. And the Ebony Repertory Theater was born out of a real need and necessity, as I saw it. Mm-hmm. The Nate Holden Performing Arts Center is at 4718 West Washington Boulevard in Los Angeles, California. And I have the blessed distinction of having been born and raised 200 yards from the front door of this facility.
How about that?
So these same streets that informed my life to return to this neighborhood in a role of cultural leadership represents a joy unspeakable for me. But I would drive my children past this building, the Nate Holden Performing Arts Center, as the cornerstone was being poured and as it was growing up as a building. It opened its doors in 2003, but I would drive by and I was wondering what is going to happen there in that theater. What kind of vision does the city of Los Angeles have, the cultural affairs department have, the community redevelopment agency, what kind of vision do they have? And they ran it for 5 years. It was not run. They had put it out to bid. They call it RFQ, request for qualifications, RFP, request for proposal. Mm-hmm. But a vision jumped in my spirit, and I put together a 2-page white paper along with the unfortunately late brilliant Mr. Israel Hicks, who was the chairman and artistic director of the Mason Gross School of the Arts at Rutgers University. For 20 years, he had run the program at SUNY Purchase. He taught the wonderful Sheldon Epps, who for 20 years was the artistic director at the Pasadena Playhouse. He had him as a student at Carnegie Mellon. He taught at Temple University as well as Juilliard. But he was one of the finest our country has ever produced. And so he was our founding artistic director. And we came together with a kitchen cabinet of about 5 people to build what is now the Ebony Repertory Theater, which holds the distinction of being the first and only professional African-American theater in the history of Los Angeles.
Wow, that's what I'm talking about.
Yes.
Wow. And so you've produced some amazing work here. And this is an award-winning theater.
Yes, it is.
You've garnered the Ovation Award.
Yes.
As well as the NAACP Theater Award.
Yes.
For productions like
A Raisin in the Sun, Two Trains Running, which was our inaugural production, The Gospel at Colonus, Paul Robeson with a wonderful Emmy Award winner, Keith David. But when I say we're the first and only African-American professional theater in Los Angeles, I'm speaking of the fact that we work under an actors' equity agreement. Equity is a union that represents stage actors, and it was founded in 1913. Mm-hmm. And so when I say professional, I don't mean just courtesies Correct. And pleasantries with regard to ushers and the security staff. We actually mean that we pay our actors a living wage. We're very proud of that distinction.
That's amazing. It's an incredible thing, and it certainly epitomizes Black excellence. I must say.
Thank you very much.
Here we are in the fall of 2007. What can people see when they come to this theater? What do you have coming up?
Well, we have a lot coming up, but I'd like to tell you about this year, 2017.
Okay.
We were honored to produce the 25th anniversary of Five Guys Named Mo. It starred the Emmy Award winner and Tony nominee Oba Babatunde, and we had a stellar cast. Okay. And the company has been received most beautifully. The audiences went wild for it. The critics went crazy for our show, Five Guys Named Mo. And we additionally had the distinction of opening the National Black Theater Festival, where 70,000 people descend on Winston-Salem, North Carolina. And we opened that 6-day festival with Five Guys Named Mo. But additionally, most recently, we've been presenting a lot of music. We've been presenting tributes to Luther Vandross by Terry Steele. And these are standing room only. Audiences are here for that. Also, we've been producing the tribute to Jackie Wilson's life, performed by the great Chester Gregory, again, standing room only. And most recently, we've had tremendous success with Dory and Holly's presentation in tribute to Marvin Gaye. So those are some of the things that we've been doing in the last several weeks, and in fact, the last several months. But upcoming, October 27th through the 29th of this year, we have the brilliant Garth Fagan Dance Company. They come out of Rochester, New York. This is their 47th year of existence. And Garth Fagan, for most people, he choreographed Lion King, which has been performed all over the world. But they've been a friend to me and to this company for the last several years. And they make their artistic home in Los Angeles, here with the Ebony Repertory Theater and our program Dance at the Holden.
Let's talk about your long career. It's really quite amazing. But you started with a foundation in theater.
Yes.
Why is that important?
Well, there's nothing in the world like having to tell the truth opposite someone each and every night. Mm. The immediate response of an audience perhaps being touched in some way by what's happening on that stage, I think that it allows the young person who wants to be an actor to search for truth in a very, very different way. There's a process of rehearsal where the character can be built and developed and cultivated. You're working with other actors who inspire. You're working with a director who might inspire. You're working with all the other designers who may inspire. And so it really, really, really prepares you for any other medium that I've ever participated in. And I've been fortunate to work in film, television, theater, certainly, in commercials and voiceovers. And then presenting in other ways, through lecture, it prepares you in a way that I don't think any other medium could.
And it is an examination of the human condition.
Absolutely. Yes.
It's rich. And so, with television, I'll ask a difficult question. Is there one particular show that was a bit more meaningful than any of the others? You've done quite a bit. Frasier, Seinfeld.
Yes, but I have to tell you, the first opportunity you ever have stands out in a very, very significant way. I did a guest star on Knight Rider.
Okay.
And getting in front of that camera, learning how to relax, preparing your material the night before, going there and what it means to be punctual when you arrive at work, getting there earlier than you need to be, so that no one's looking for you, to get in hair and makeup and have that preparation happen, and then to go on that set and all of those people around who get quiet so that they can say action, and you begin to roll, and then again, all of your preparation comes to bear, all of the things that you've ever desired hopefully come to bear, and you experience joy in the work, because the work that I do, when I've been able to do it, represents joy. It's not work for me.
Wow.
So I would have to say Knight Rider from that perspective. But having the opportunity to play Whoopi Goldberg's brother.
There you go.
On the Whoopi Show on NBC was a complete joy, because I find Whoopi to be a major human being and she's a major artist. And the opportunity to play with so many extraordinary personalities during our time shooting the Whoopi Show there in New York City was yet another joy.
And in film, you were in Robert Townsend's Hollywood Shuffle.
Yes, my film debut. And I always, whenever I see Robert, I always remind him by way of thank you for giving me that opportunity to be with him and Keenan Ivory Wayans and Paul Mooney and countless others
who were
a part of the Hollywood Shuffle, because again, it gave me my start, my first resume item on screen, and it's just a memorable and most important subject that Robert and Keenan and others tackled. So it holds that significance for me as well.
That's right. And it was funny, but it was that the subject matter as well. Where do you see it? So this was in the 80s when that film was done.
It was released by Samuel Goldwyn in 1987. We made it in 1986.
Okay. So where do you see that topic now? If you were to look at that topic you guys explored on that film, where do you see us now in terms of black actors and how they're cast and such?
I think we're still living at the center of the Hollywood Shuffle.
Okay.
I think that the numbers have grown in terms of employment. Mm-hmm. But when we're talking about images, when we're talking about the historical tropes, I think they're very present today. They are disguised differently. But I think the Hollywood Shuffle and the nicheification of the black artist is still very, very much in vogue. So I think that unfortunately it's a worthy conversation that is not only 30 years old with regard to the advent of the Hollywood Shuffle, but it in fact it's over 100 years old, this conversation about the Hollywood Shuffle with regard to the black artist.
You've done over 100 commercials, television, film, voiceover. If you were talking to an up-and-coming actor, what would be a key piece of advice that you would give to that person?
Find your purpose. Mm. The fourth chapter of Ephesians in the very first verse says, I therefore, a servant of the Lord, beseech ye that ye walk worthy of the chosen vocation wherewith ye were called. What do you feel called to? What is your purpose? And then when we talk about passion, what are you highly motivated to do? Mm. What are you highly motivated to do? So if you get a chance to find your purpose, and then you find that thing that you're highly motivated to do, which can turn into passion, then the possibilities are limitless. And so purpose, passion, and possibilities.
I have a direct relationship with the Old Globe Theater in
yes.
San Diego. So I saw that you performed there at the Old Globe. You literally have done it all.
Well, I'm telling you, my summer at the Old Globe was one of the greatest summers of my life. My wife was infanticipating with our first child, who was born September the 17th of 1993.
Okay.
But I played a father.
Mm-hmm.
The character was named Mickey,
right.
And it was a play called Burning Hope, a world premiere that we played there in the round at what was then the Cassius Carter Theater.
Mm-hmm.
And being there with the late Miriam Colon, who was the founder of the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater, she was working on the outdoor stage, and Hal Holbrook was doing King Lear inside the big theater.
Mm.
And so being as a part of that company there that summer, with the great Jack O'Brien, one of the great artistic leaders in this nation and one of the great directors in this nation, or any nation for that matter. It was a complete joy staying at Shiley Terrace. And being there as a part of the Old Globe, it was just wonderful. And it's interesting, 1993 was the first year I ever played a father. And the fact that my first child was born that year, it was something spiritually and energetic about that reality, because on television, on an episode of Rock, I played a father.
Mm.
And then I did a film for Universal called Heart and Souls, where I played a father as well. So in all three mediums, I played a father, in addition to a commercial directed by Bill Duke for Crest. It was a Crest toothpaste campaign. I also played a father. So four mediums,
wow.
I got a chance to play a father for the first time when we were expecting our first child.
Incredible.
Yes.
I understand there's some rumblings about a book that you're putting together.
Yes.
That, a highly anticipated book.
Yeah, I'm very, very excited about chronicling the four generations of my family in this show business. You know, the working title now is Blackface, Bandstands, Broadway, and Hollywood.
Okay.
And it will examine four generations of my family. I'm very, very proud of those who went before me. And I stand on their shoulders, and I cannot live, in my feeling, beneath the privilege of what they afforded me through their dignity, through their integrity, and through their hard work. Because the times in which they were performing were very, very hostile,
correct.
Very bellicose, mean-spirited times, not only in this country, but abroad. And they stood up with a great deal of integrity, dignity, and grace. And so they had a standard of excellence, and even the two grandparents I never had an opportunity to meet. I still function every single day hoping to honor their legacy.
And that you certainly have, and I commend that very much so.
Thank you.
In the future, where can our viewers see Wren T. Brown?
Well, you can go on Amazon right now and see an episode of Transparent, and I'm so fond of that show. It tackles a major, major theme that our country and the world is facing. The reality of sensitivity of the transgender community. But again, finally, it's about humanity.
Mm.
And those themes are universal.
Right.
So I'm looking forward to anyone wanting to go to Amazon and to see some work that I was able to do on Transparent. But I'm excited about making my directorial debut in the theater.
All right.
I'm going to the Lone Tree Arts Center in Denver, Colorado in March of 2018 to direct August Wilson's Fences.
Oh, that's gonna be beautiful.
I'm thrilled.
I would suggest that, you know, I understand actors, if they learn Shakespeare, it's said that they can do anything else with this foundation. But I would suggest it's a similar thing with August Wilson pieces, perhaps. I mean, there's a certain musicality with that and structure with his pieces.
Yes. Well, the thing that I think allows an actor to do anything is knowing him or herself.
Mm. Okay.
Sometimes we want to work outside of ourselves, outside of our cultural experience. But I think when you're first able to deal in cultural specificity and understanding what your own humanity is about, what kind of person are you? What kind of empathy do you possess? What kind of sympathy do you possess? What kind of sensitivity to difference do you possess? And I think learning all those things about the self will cause you to be able to grab hold of someone like William Shakespeare, or someone like August Wilson, or someone like Tennessee Williams, or Philip Hayes Dean, or Lorraine Hansberry. Mm. You can grab hold of those things because they wrote real human beings and real human experiences. So it's about taking the empirical and the experiential human journey. And if you're able to do that first, and to know yourself, and to go down into that little place that is the inner sanctum of yourself, and you know yourself, you can grab hold of these works and you're likely to turn in a brilliant performance.
I love it indeed. Here on Theater Corner, we always discuss diversity and inclusion. So what says Wren T. Brown on this topic?
Well, diversity and inclusion, I love that they are combined. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes we hear the discussion of diversity, and diversity could be where clean-shaven white men decide to let white men with beards into their club.
Mm-hmm.
That could represent diversity.
Right.
But inclusion for me implies that all are welcome, you know? And so the Ebony Repertory Theater, as a part of the cultural landscape of Los Angeles, I just think is vitally important. We are a culturally specific theater, but I believe it's very, very important because the dominant culture theaters don't ever have to refer to themselves as white.
Mm.
They exist as they exist. They do the work that they do. But I think it's very, very important to have this particular voice where black leadership is producing and directing and designing the work in such a way that the work becomes more authentic. And, you know, and we are in a great tradition of theater companies historically in this country who have done this work. If we go back to 1821 with James Hewlett and the African Grove Theater in New York City,
mm.
if we talk about the Anita Bush Players around 1915 in New York, the Rose McClendon Players in New York City, the Lafayette Players in New York City, the American Negro Theater Company
right.
in New York City, which produced, of course, Mr. Sidney Poitier and Mr. Harry Belafonte, among countless others. They had the great success with Anna Lou Costa early on. But of course, we then go to the Negro Ensemble Company, forming itself in 1967. And so Ebony Repertory Theater attempts to live in the great grand tradition of all those other companies where excellence was the standard. And so the diversity and inclusion doesn't happen necessarily all within one company, but it can happen with other companies. And the city and the cultural leadership in the companies don't have to be balkanized. We are still a part of one community as an accumulated entity. So that's what I say on diversity and inclusion.
Well said, sir. So well said.
Thank you.
I want to thank you for coming here and enjoying us here at Theater Corner. I appreciate it. I love everything you're doing.
Michael, thank you.
Particularly with this theater.
Yes.
And I'm glad more people will learn about this theater and come enjoy it. You are black excellence, sir.
Oh, you honor me. You honor me, Michael. I must say in closing that it is a complete thrill for me to be here with you and all of the viewers here at Theater Corner. I've watched the work that you're doing, and I really, really am so positively impacted by it with every episode that I've seen. So I thank you from the bottom of my heart for having me.
I appreciate that, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
And thank you, viewers, for tuning in for another episode of Theater Corner, and we'll see you next time.